Today, we are joined by Ariana Huffington, who is here to talk about her new book, The Sleep Revolution. She claims that sleeping will make you more productive, and that sleeping is really good for you. This is really innovative stuff that talks about sleeping for 8 hours a night. Sleeping for 8 hours a night in a cool place, under covers. Fascinating stuff. Very excited to have her here today. You can tell how happy I am from the sound of my voice.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to the Poncho section. Today, Ethan and I discuss people who make terrible movies and how they keep getting money to make more of these terrible, terrible movies.
How's your week going?
It's a bummer.
Yeah?
This whole week's been a bummer. Yeah, it's just, I don't know, work's just kind of taking a lot out of me this week. And I feel like I haven't slept as well as I should be. And that kind of wrangles me a little bit.
Yeah.
So, it hasn't been fantastic. I'm looking forward to Friday.
Yes.
And how about you?
I'm probably pretty much in the same boat. Mm. World's going nuts. Last debate happened.
Yeah, did you see the debate last night?
I did not. I decided I would avoid that headache.
Yeah. Because good for you. It's like a car wreck to me.
Yeah, I figured there's nothing I was going to gain from it.
Yeah, I think
besides like an aneurysm maybe. Speaking of things that are going downhill, mm-hmm. and that are terrible.
Mm-hmm.
There's a few people that we want to discuss today.
Yeah.
And we want to figure out how they are able to keep making these terrible, terrible movies.
I don't know. I mean, I think the market's changing a little bit nowadays, where I think these movies, I think a lot of them for a while, yeah, they did come out in theaters for a while, but now you're not hearing as much about them. And I think maybe that a lot of them are straight to like streaming services.
Yeah.
That seems to be the new way to go about it, because I think there might be more money in that. I think we should start with Adam Sandler.
Let's go for it.
Because he has signed a six-movie deal. Six movies with Netflix.
Yeah.
And that was surprising to me when that first came about, because he was making a movie consistently every year that was coming out in theaters.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, and they did, they would do fairly well as far as
money-wise, yeah.
Yes, money-wise. But I don't know why he decided to do that, and I think he just has a great manager, a great agent, because his career post-SNL,
yeah.
since the 90s, has been amazing.
Oh, it's incredible, and a lot of it is through his own company, the Happy Madison Productions.
Right, he's put, and he's made movies from that company that don't involve him at all.
Right, which are
that don't
also...
That don't have him in it.
He's not a prominent actor, which are also, they pretty much, I would say the majority of the movies that fall under Happy Madison Productions have been garbage.
Mostly. I'm a sucker for Grandma's Boy. I love Grandma's Boy, as stupid as it is. But yeah, you're right, under that umbrella, they're really not pretty good. And it's mostly like his friends.
Mm-hmm.
David Spade and
Rob Schneider.
Sometimes John Lovitz makes an appearance,
yeah.
which I like.
John Lovitz is great.
Because I like John Lovitz.
Everybody likes John Lovitz.
Yeah, but Adam Sandler is kind of a mystery in a lot of ways, because of that class of in SNL, we have him, Schneider, Spade, mm-hmm. Farley. I feel like if Farley would have probably continued to do more.
I can see that.
He would still be successful to this day. Because he was also supposed to do Shrek as well.
That
was made
I heard him. He recorded like a bunch of stuff.
Yeah.
And then he died. He recorded it in his type of voice. The whole Scottish kind of thing wasn't
yeah, didn't that, exist. That was a Mike Myers add-on, because he just thought that made sense.
Yeah. I mean, I liked Shrek. I liked the first one. And then they should have stopped after that.
Yeah. But Shrek's good. I have no issues with Shrek. But anyway, I mean... Yeah, so it was always surprising to me that Adam Sandler was the one that that be so successful. But be that as it may, his first couple movies I was always a big fan of, especially when I was a kid. I was really a big fan of Billy Madison, Happy Gilmore.
Yeah,
when I look back,
Big Daddy is
Big
another
Daddy.
Great one.
Yeah, when I look back at them now, they do seem kind of silly to me. I mean, I can still enjoy them, but it's not the same. Like I do,
right.
I could see why adults or like film critics wouldn't like him, because they are really stupid. It's just a lot of poop humor,
yeah,
pretty much. So, yeah, it's really stupid, but those movies did really well, and they resonated with, like, our audience, at least when we were that age. And I feel like my theory is, as time went on, as our generation got older, we kind of grew out of that humor.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was like very adolescent humor.
Oh, yeah.
But at the same time, he was transitioning. He had kids, so he was kind of making some movies that were more family-friendly. I think he did one, Bedtime Stories,
mm-hmm.
like Jack and Jill. I feel like those are like more kids.
Ugh, Jack and Jill.
I think, or maybe not that one, but the Blended. Like, it seemed like he was mm-hmm. more catering towards kids.
I guess.
I think he had some kind of an audience there. But I think what's happening now is he made this deal with Netflix because he's not... Maybe his last couple movies didn't do as well in the box office, if I had to guess. And that's probably why he was able to make this deal with Netflix to make 6 movies. That way he doesn't have to worry about those numbers. I could be wrong. Yeah, very wrong. I mean, but that's just what I think.
What seems to be going on is that regardless of like is how well they do, they always seem to be doing really well. Like before we started this, I mentioned how... The studios will give him like $80 million to make the movie. Yeah. And no matter how shitty they are, which mm-hmm. they are,
mm-hmm.
they somehow end up making over $200 million. Yeah. So I think the way that they get away with that is because he's basically just hiring his friends. They go on vacation in almost every single movie.
Yeah.
They just chill.
Well, Grown-Ups.
Grown-Ups. Yeah. And then they decided to make a Grown-Ups 2. Which,
yeah, because Grown Ups 1 was so riveting. I think, yeah, you're right. He does hire a lot of
product placement.
Oh, tons. Which,
Jack and Jill, that's the entire movie.
Well, there was...
product placement.
KFC, I remember, was a big product placement in Grown Ups.
Actually, if you notice, there's a lot of his movies have KFC in it.
Yeah.
Even in Rain On Me.
Oh, yeah, but that's not him, though.
That is him. That was a Happy really? Madison. Yeah.
Really? That's
Rain Over Me. That's the name of it. There was like he moved into his new apartment at the end of the movie. Spoilers. But when he moved into his new apartment, there you see in the background there's like a statue of the Colonel for reasons.
Yeah.
Nobody knows why, but
maybe he has a thing with KFC. That's interesting. But it's funny you say that, though, about product placement, because I read an old Roger Ebert review, because
mm-hmm.
I love Roger Ebert reviews. And it was for Happy Gilmore. He gave it 1 star, and he said the entire movie was just product placement. That was the whole thing.
Really?
He was naming off product placement for like golf balls,
mm-hmm.
for Subway was like a big one in that. And Pepsi, I think, was another one. Yeah, he was just rattling off. He said he sat through the movie just rattling off all the product placement.
Holy crap.
There might be...
I never even noticed that. And thinking back on it, I do remember the Subway ad, but I don't think I remembered all the other product placement. He must have been doing this from day one.
Yeah, I mean, that's something to consider, too, in this whole thing, that maybe product placement had a lot to do with it. But like you said, his movies did really well, and there were some... I loved The Wedding Singer.
The Wedding Singer was great.
Yeah. So, and again, they're dumb, but there's a lot to enjoy as well.
It just seems that lately he's been very lazy in the way he's done stuff. I haven't seen. I haven't seen a lot of the recent ones. Like Pixels, I heard was garbage. He's had his hand with both of the Paul Blart movies.
Yeah. Yeah, he's really just phoning it in.
Yeah. Jack and Jill was horrible. The Grown Ups movie was horrible. I actually didn't mind Funny People, not gonna lie. I know I'm in a very minority of that.
No, it wasn't. I see, a lot of people liked it. I think it could have been better.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was things they could have done. I don't think it's his fault. I think it's Apatow's fault.
Yeah, okay, I can see that.
Because a lot of times with him, first of all, his movies are always too long. And it almost felt like 2 movies. It felt super disjointed to me. It wasn't pieced together well. That's how I felt.
I could see that.
But there were a lot of great scenes in it, though.
I thought there is one that always sticks out, and it's when he as in Adam Sandler's character, is at the bar and he's talking to Eminem.
Yeah.
And I guess Seth Rogen is just chilling and Ray Romano is there.
Yeah.
And I guess Eminem is like, yo, what the fuck is Everybody Loves Raymond doing staring at me? And he just yells at him. It's just really funny having, I guess, Eminem yell at Ray Romano.
Yeah, that is a funny scene. Yeah, I mean, there was potential. And he was good in that, too. I think it's more the director's problem in that case. And that's not to say Adam Sandler is very talented. Yeah. I love the movie Punch Drunk Love, and that's not a funny movie. He's just a very good actor in it. So he has the talent. I think what's happening right now is he's just gotten tired and he's phoning it in.
Mm-hmm.
Why would he still keep doing it? I don't know. Maybe he just sees it.
Making millions. Easy.
Yeah. He might be one of those people too. I mean, if you think about it, there are people who, you know, we say if we're that rich, we could just like walk away. But he might have a different kind of mentality where it's like, it could all go away. I got to keep working until...
Maybe.
You know, I don't really know. I think the Netflix deal for him is really smart. The annoying thing is you got to see his stupid trailers every time you open up Netflix.
Because he's got two out right now. The Ridiculous Six and the Do-Over, right?
Yeah, that's a David Spade one.
Too, right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which I just grabbed some of the ratings from like Metacritic and Rotten Tomatoes, and
they're all terrible, right?
Yeah. Oh, I didn't even realize they made a Joe Dirt 2. When the hell did that come out?
Yeah, that's the thing too. A lot of these movies kind of just go under the radar, and it came out last year.
Yeah, in 2015. Yeah. It got a 0%, and so did the Ridiculous 6 on Rotten Tomatoes.
I think that's another one that didn't come out to theaters, or maybe just very select. I think that's a bigger thing. A lot of movies now, it's really only the big budget and I guess a few independent theaters, but there's a lot of stuff that just never sees a theater anymore. And it's not as weird as it used to be. Like if you had it back in the day, if you had a movie that was like straight to video,
okay,
everyone was like, oh, well, obviously it sucks. Or they would have like Disney sequels that would go straight to video. Do you remember that?
Like, wouldn't it be like Aladdin movies?
Yeah, it's like Aladdin 6.
Or the Little Mermaids. Yeah. They had a bunch of those.
Yeah. Exactly. They do that a lot. So
Beauty and the Beast 3. Yeah. Back to the furry. I don't know.
Back to the Beast.
Back to the Beast.
He's a beast again. No. But again, that's what used to be, but now it's totally different. So, yeah, I didn't know there was a Joe Dirt 2. Yeah. That's really interesting. But yeah, on the topic of Sandler, though, I think generally he's going to keep doing this. He has the Netflix deal.
Yeah.
From there, maybe he'll decide to hang it up and start doing more serious movies. I saw that he's in a upcoming Noah Baumbach movie. I don't know if you know him. He did The Squid and the Whale and Greenberg with Ben Stiller.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I know Greenberg.
And this movie also has Ben Stiller too. He's worked with him on like a couple movies. So
okay, cool.
The two of them will be together in this one.
I think like when he does his dramatic roles, he's actually really good.
Mm-hmm.
For the most part, he's really good, and it's unfortunate because I think that's one of the, like the big issues a lot of people have with him is that the majority of the movies that he is coming out with, he's just completely phoning it in.
Yeah.
Doesn't give a shit. When we know he actually has the ability to do pretty well. Like I liked Rain Over Me.
Yeah.
I thought that was really interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually like Click too, which was kind of it was more of a dark kind of comedy.
Yeah.
That was really pretty great. And just it's unfortunate that he kind of just, I don't know, it seems lazy.
Yeah, well, I think you run into that problem, though, if you try to do too much of anything.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love Woody Allen, but Woody Allen makes a movie every year.
Yeah.
So they're not all going to be great.
Right.
Yeah, and Adam Sandler kind of suffers from that same thing, but none of them are spectacular.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little different. So I don't know. It'll be interesting to see where his career goes from here. I'm not really going to pay attention to it.
No.
But
me neither.
But, you know, we'll see. It's weird because I always say this. There's not as many... you don't see as many good comedies coming out anymore. They all just seem so dumb to me. There's nothing like the classics.
Yeah.
But there's...
Come on, Mel.
Yeah.
Give us some more.
No, but see, but here's the thing, though. He doesn't have to.
No, he doesn't have to.
And maybe he shouldn't, because he wants to keep his legacy where it is.
That's fair. I think he just should come back and just save the whole comedy genre.
Yeah. or maybe do something to save the Dracula one that wasn't so good.
Yeah.
That was his last one.
Yeah, just do one more that's a little better than that.
Yeah. We'll see if Spaceballs 2 ever... We'll see if Spaceballs 2 ever happens.
Yeah.
So we wanted to talk also about some of these other guys who do... I guess not the same as Adam Sandler, but they're more... I guess in the same realm as Mel Brooks doing spoof movies.
Ugh.
Which is something we don't see much of nowadays, and probably for a good reason.
Mm-hmm.
So we were talking before this started about these two guys who I didn't realize it was the same directors who had directed all these movies that had directed Epic Movie. And the other one was Date Movie.
Disaster Movie.
Disaster Movie. And Meet the Spartans
was another one. Meet the Spartans.
And I'm looking on IMDb and they have 2 stars.
Yep. See, that makes sense.
These movies, the real problem with these movies, because I love a good B movie. I love the movie Teeth because I think it's hilarious.
Okay.
But... But again, those movies are not meant necessarily as spoofs. Like they're campy.
Yeah.
But they're not meant as spoofs, and they use B actors, and it's a little different. Whereas this uses B actors that you really don't know. You might know one name from these movies. Although actually, this one has a couple people. They
use like a lot of like sort of celebrities.
Jennifer
like
Coolidge.
Yeah, she's in a lot of those.
Daryl Hammond.
Jennifer Coolidge is a lot of them. They use like Carmen Electra a lot. They used,
yeah.
I don't know if they did use Paris Hilton. They used, I think they maybe used Kim Kardashian or something like that.
Crispin Glover's in this one as Willy Wonka. See, I actually never saw any of these movies because the trailers were enough to turn me off to them.
It's terrible. We're talking about Jason Friedberg and Aaron Seltzer, by the way.
That's right. Jason Friedberg and Aaron Seltzer, who have directed Epic Movie, Meet the Spartans. Did they direct Date Movie?
Date Movie. They started out with the Scary Movie, pretty much. They were some of the writers for Scary Movie.
Okay.
Then they moved on to Date Movie, Epic Movie, Disaster Movie, Meet the Spartans, Vampires Suck, The Starving Games, some movie named Best Night Ever. I never even heard of that. Another movie named Superfast. Also never heard of that.
Yeah. Well, I think the ones that we're seeing, the ones that have come out recently, haven't been out in theaters. I think that's kind of what I was talking about before.
Oh, really?
A lot of these, I don't think so, unless I just didn't hear about them. But I think that's what I was saying before, is that a lot of these movies now are coming straight to streaming services. They're not letting these movies like this, they don't get out there. I mean, think about the Sharknado movies. Those movies...
That's actually a really good point.
Because those movies don't come out. They're on the Sci-Fi Channel, I think.
Yeah, right? That and I believe they're on Netflix as well. Yeah. But that's like a good example of like they're campy and they know it.
Yeah.
Another great one is the Tucker and Dale versus Evil. Have you ever seen that?
That's a funny movie.
That's a really funny movie, but it's like has that kind of like it's aware of itself being sort of B.
Well, it does level. It does it well because it takes. I think with spoofs, you still have to have some sort of story,
mm-hmm.
and you can't throw too much into one thing. And the problem is, they try to jam a year's worth of movies into one stupid fucking movie, and it doesn't work.
Yeah.
And I'm saying this as someone who hasn't seen the movies, but I can just assume that these movies were bad.
I started watching...
Just from the trailers, they look stupid.
I think I started watching both Epic Movie and Date Movie, and about maybe 20 minutes in, I turned it off.
Yeah.
It was horrible. Because it's, again, when we reference Mel Brooks, he's making a legitimate satire. He's making a commentary about that specific genre or something involving that movie. These guys, I consider these reference movies. They make constant references to shit that's going on in pop culture today, and that's it. It's not funny.
It's lazy to me.
It's very lazy.
It's just really lazy. And I'm looking at one right now that's called Vampires Suck.
Yep.
That was got by these guys.
Mm-hmm.
3.5 on IMDb, which I think is honestly their top rating. And that's out of 10.
On Rotten Tomatoes, it got a 4%.
Okay. Not bad.
Meet the Spartans got 2%.
Yeah.
Which, well, I remember there was a scene from that where it was like, I don't know. They were, I guess, I saw, I think, maybe for all of these, maybe I was 20 minutes in and then turned it off. Yeah. I don't know why I kept trying it out, but I remember for that one, Meet the Spartans, there was like a quote unquote, I don't know, I guess they were trying to make it like this epic scene. There's that whole thing with like they're kicking the people into the pit or whatever, and it's like,
that's all I saw, yeah.
Yeah, and like, I guess they started doing like a dance competition for, what is it, what was that dance competition? I think maybe it was on Fox or whatever.
Dancing with the Stars?
No, not Dancing with the Stars. It was like they had the, it's the Lewis Carroll. Alice in Wonderland. The Jabberwockies.
Okay.
You know what I'm talking about? Like, it's like a whole dance.
So you think you can dance. Okay. So it's like the American Idol of dancing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Okay. So I think they tried to make a spoof of that where it's just like, there's like a shit going on in Sparta and then all of a sudden there's a dance crew.
Yes, and that's the problem, like, right there.
What's going on? Why? This is not funny.
They're playing, I hate to, this sounds really pretentious, but they're playing to like the lowest common denominator.
Oh, absolutely.
Like they're like putting it in like the dumbest people who just need to be, who need like stimulation, yep, like constantly.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just really sad. And obviously not a lot of people are buying it. Yeah. But I'm looking at this vampire thing, and there's a vampire, there's a funny vampire movie that I really like. It's called What We Do in the Shadows.
Oh, I remember you telling me about that.
Yeah, and that's done really well. Where it's not really a spoof, necessarily, of anything specific,
mm-hmm,
but we've seen the vampires in movies and,
sure,
everything. And it's really, it's just a funny concept, and it's and has a story where it's three vampires living together. They're roommates, you know, dealing with, like, regular issues, and they're not like coming at you like trying to force this stuff down your throat, like, is this funny, like, let's, yeah, throw a dance competition, like, just right, trying to throw things, like, no, like, sit back and just pay attention, you know. And so, and the fact they're doing it, these guys, after the third or fourth movie, you would have to think like maybe this just isn't good. I mean, I can't imagine they're sitting back and saying like, oh, this is comedy gold.
It's insulting. I remember I read an article where it was where they were talking about their success or whatever, because I was really curious. It was like, what, how do they keep making these movies? Yeah. I think I've looked this up before. I was like, why do people keep giving them money? Why do people keep seeing this crap?
Yeah.
And I remember them talking about it as they were saying like, yeah, we just try to do things that we think are funny, which just to me is like, you have the worst sense of humor I think I've ever met. Like, I mean, I've ever seen. Like, this is terrible.
I mean, obviously, they watch a lot of movies because they sit and, yeah, they watch them and they take it in and they really, so they do that.
Yeah.
They're fans, but not every fan should be making their own movie.
Right.
And they, you know, maybe they're well shot. I don't know. Maybe they have those kind of talents. I'm sure they have some kind of directorial talents. I don't know. You'd have to ask the actors involved. I really have no idea. Know.
All I know is they somehow, I don't remember which one. One of them has, their father is involved with the industry.
Yeah.
Because they were involved in writing the Leslie Nielsen movie Spy Hard.
Oh, okay.
So through some family member, mm-hmm, they got involved, which I guess kind of makes sense considering, like, I guess that started bringing like Leslie Nielsen into like the scary movies.
Yeah.
Towards, right, the end.
Right, but but those weren't, I mean, these guys had some kind of, right, involvement with them, but they weren't the directors.
Right,
though.
Right.
And those movies are silly, too, but not like this, though. I mean, they had some good stuff in
there.
Yeah,
these are legitimately terrible.
Yeah, the scary movies had some good things.
Yeah.
Good things going for them. And, yeah, it's just, it's really weird. And at this point now, it's so tired, they keep throwing them out there. And like we said, we haven't even heard of these.
Right.
So, I mean, that's another thing, too. Like, why are they still doing it? Are they still making money? And, you know, when I'm looking at it, it's like, okay, the budget, I'm trying to find if there's any, if it says what the budget is for these movies, but it doesn't really say. There's estimates. So, it's not...
What are we showing the estimate to be?
Estimate is $20 million, which is big, but not huge.
Right, I can see that for this kind of crap.
Yeah, but see, I'm on this Vampire Suck thing, and it says the estimated budget was $20 million, and by November of 2010, so this came out in 2010, it had grossed almost $37 million in the U.S., which is pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, they made back their money.
Yeah, which is kind of crazy. And, I mean, this was 6 years ago, so a lot's definitely changed.
Yeah. Seeing these movies?
Yeah.
I mean, it's got to be like 14-year-olds.
Dave Foley was in this movie. Dave Foley from Kids in the Hall.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, I don't know what... I'm just seeing his name in the credits. But
that's unfortunate.
This is someone else. But I think a lot of these actors, because they're B actors, you can probably pay them scale, I would think. Yeah. So you don't have to give anyone. So that you save money in that area too.
I mean, that makes sense.
So I'm thinking maybe that's their strategy. I'm thinking the only way they're able to make more money is, I mean, the only way they're able to get more funding or able to make more of these movies is because they don't spend as much. They don't spend as much on the actors. And
yeah, they're not spending too much on it. And it seems that each time they do make the money back, at least.
I don't know. We're also only in one part of the country. We don't know. In other parts of the country, they may love this stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's elitist New York vibes.
It's hard to know, though. It's confusing to me as to why they would keep getting more money for this.
Yeah.
But they still do. And now maybe they're just going straight to Hulu or Amazon or wherever.
I don't know.
And the studios are saying to them, they can't be saying to them, hey guys, like, we loved it. maybe they're just like, hey, this makes money.
Right.
Give us more money. Here you go.
Yeah, I think that's totally how it keeps happening. I mean, they have a Metacritic score of 24, each of them.
I don't even want to watch these it wouldn't be fun even to watch these.
No.
Because it's like that, it's trying to be something it's not.
Yeah.
That's enough on that.
Yeah.
I think what will happen is...
It's becoming a depressing episode.
Well, there'll be more movies. They'll come out this year and they'll spoof them.
Yeah.
And, you know, they'll spoof the superhero movies. They'll spoof Batman or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
We know it's coming.
I think we should talk about a genius on this list. Someone who is so innovative.
Yeah.
Who thinks up the most clever plot twists imaginable.
Oh, God. Don't say his name.
I'm talking about M. Night Shyamalan Ding Dong.
M. Night Shyamalan.
M. Night Shyamalan.
You know, I was a fan of M. Night back in the day. I liked The Sixth Sense. Unbreakable, I remember liking. I haven't seen it in a long time, so I can't really say. But, you know, I remember it being good. And then Signs came out.
That came out.
And I kind of liked Signs at the time.
Okay.
But I was young, you know, so I don't know. It was an interesting concept. Now looking back on it, it's really stupid.
It's very stupid.
Yeah. And then after that, he did The Village, which was not great. And it kind of just started to go really
then
downhill.
Then there was like Lady in the Water, and then The Happening.
Might be the worst movie I've ever seen.
I actually haven't seen it. I saw somebody doing a review about it, and I was like, this looks like amazingly awful.
That was the first time ever being in a movie theater where I really felt like I needed to walk out. And I didn't. Because I had never done that before. It wasn't my thing. But I was pretty easygoing when I went to movies. I would see the comedies with friends. Be like, yeah, that was funny. That was fun. Yeah, we would have a good time. And then I saw that pile of shit. I was so angry. I never felt like angry towards a movie before.
What? You weren't all down with Narfs?
Oh my gosh. And Paul Giamatti. He's a good actor, but that movie made him look terrible. He had this horrible, this stutter that was not believable by any means.
Well, I think it's like this weird, I'm going to call it the Shyamalan effect, where you're an actor and then you start working on one of these movies and at a certain point you're just like, oh, this is, no, I'm just gonna phone this in the rest of the... I don't know what I signed on for, but this is terrible.
Well, it's really interesting if you look at his movies over the years, how it's when it started out, he had, so his first movie, Bruce Willis.
Yeah.
You know, and Haley Joel Osment, who was, you know, child actor, but you have Bruce Willis, big actor, right? And then the next movie, that movie's successful, the next movie has Bruce Willis plus Samuel L. Jackson. Yeah. That movie's pretty successful. Next movie, you get Mel Gibson.
Mel Gibson.
And Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah, man.
You know, you get good people. So, and Signs did pretty well, too, even though it had some weird things.
Yeah, like, I guess that was the start of his, I don't know, craziness.
But again, his track record was really good.
Yeah.
And he had good people in his movies, so I think he was able to get more people for his movies. Then he had The Village, which had mixed reviews.
Yeah.
But Village had Adrian Brody, I remember. Bryce Dallas Howard, you know.
I actually didn't see The Village. Okay. I don't know.
Joaquin again, Sigourney Weaver.
Yeah, like, I don't know if I was going to see it, but then shortly after I heard that the revelation was just so kind of awful that it just wasn't worth it.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, that's a good enough reason to avoid it, I guess. but he still had good people. And then I'm thinking after that was when he did the plant movie, The Happening.
No, before that, Lady in the Water came before The Happening.
Oh, okay, so he had Paul Giamatti,
yeah,
who had, I think he had just come off of Sideways. He had gotten an Oscar nomination.
Yeah, so that was in 2006, so that's right around that time.
Yeah, so he was a big name. And then you go to The Happening,
yeah,
and you have Marky Mark. And Marky
the rest
Mark
of his funky bunch.
Yeah, and that movie was terrible. And
Zooey Deschanel was in that.
Zooey Deschanel, too.
And John Leguizamo.
And John Leguizamo. So you have good people for a while, but you can start to see. I mean, I guess you get Mark Wahlberg. I guess that the Lady in the Water wasn't enough to deter him. They gave him one pass. Yeah. But nowadays, do you see any big names in any of his movies?
He did. Oh, he actually was the director of After Earth. That was the movie starring Will Smith and his son, Jaden Smith.
Wow.
Yeah. Basically,
I didn't realize.
I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that Will Smith was just like, I'm going to make a movie for my son. Let me contact M. Night Shyamalan.
You're right. Because he did. Okay, so he did The Last Airbender,
mm-hmm,
which I never saw.
I heard terrible things about it.
Yes, 4.2.
I heard they whitewashed it or something like that.
Yeah, I don't.
That or they just like completely missed.
Okay, had Dev Patel, but he.
Yeah.
But he wasn't well known at that point, was he?
I think this was after.
Was it after Slumdog?
After Slumdog, yeah.
Okay, so maybe my argument's totally wrong then. That
he somehow keeps getting people, but it's just
maybe
like.
Maybe not as many though?
Yeah. I mean, that Last Airbender made, what was it, $131 million, something like that.
I do want to see The Visit because.
That one actually got the best score on Rotten Tomatoes, which was a 64.
Yeah, that's not bad. He makes me angry, M. Night Shyamalan. I think Lady in the Water made me so angry because I felt really cheated because I liked his movies for so long and I gave him a chance and I thought he was interesting. And I feel like he's a fraud. I feel like he had one good idea. He's like, oh, he's dead the whole time. Spoiler for Sixth Sense if you haven't seen it. And after that, I mean, The Village, like, they're in a little community.
Yeah.
It's like, yeah, they're like Amish people then. Like, I don't...
Well, I think what's really funny and...
It's not that surprising.
South Park touched on it.
Yeah.
I don't remember exactly what the situation was, but there was a predicament, so they got a bunch of directors to be like, well, what would you do in this situation? And each director, I think they got like Michael Bay, they got a few other people, they were like, well, that's not a movie, that's just an idea. So for him specifically, it was just like, all right, that's not a plot, that's not a story, that's just a twist.
Yeah.
That's all you keep coming up with. It's just like you're just trying to have some major plot twist and it's just we can see it coming.
Yeah. Yeah. That's and I think that was the thing he originally started with and thought he could keep going off of that, and you realize you have to actually build a compelling story.
Yeah. You probably just start with a good story.
And something that's not ridiculous. Like talking to plants. I mean, come on, guy.
There was also Devil, which I didn't see that. I heard that was also a...
It's like an evil elevator.
Something like that.
Oh, sorry. Oh.
It's the elevator calling.
No, why can't I shut that off? Well, you know, we're going to let that go. yeah, this is the elevator calling.
It's M. Night Shyamalan. He heard what we were saying about him.
So anyway, M. Night is is someone who makes me very angry.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that at some point we can rekindle our relationship. If I'm going to try, maybe I'll see that one that he did last year.
The Visit?
The Visit. And, you know, see, he's got one coming up. I mean, he's someone who keeps getting money, too.
Yeah.
Because I think his movies do okay.
What's he got coming up?
He has... called Labor of Love. A movie called Labor of Love. I'm sorry. My phone keeps going. You know what? I'm gonna close.
Well, I think this is a good time to move on to one of the other people. And I don't know if you wanted to discuss any other people besides the ones that I mentioned to you, but...
We can touch on a couple more.
There was, I guess, Michael Bay.
Yeah, Michael Bay is a different animal because Michael Bay will...
He's a weird anomaly.
Michael Bay will never disappear.
Yeah.
Because he will get... His movies are based purely around special effects
mm-hmm.
and exploding shit.
Yep.
So as long as he's able to do that, he can throw whoever he wants. Let's get yeah. him. We're gonna make it explode.
Yeah. Special effects, blowing shit up, getting half naked women. He likes mm-hmm. to get attractive girls.
Mm-hmm.
Pseudo racist comments in his movies. Juvenile jokes.
Yeah. Yeah.
He makes the lowest common denominator movies.
Yeah.
And people buy it up.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's true. I don't see him going anywhere. Mm-hmm. He's just one of those people who I just won't go see his movies. Because they're also super long, too. They're like, yeah. Those Transformers movies are like 3 hours
Transformers,
long.
Transformers, he's got, the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles stuff yeah. going on right
oh,
now.
Oh, but the weird one, like not the good old
no,
ones.
No, yeah, the old ones were great.
Yeah.
Yeah, give me some, what was it? Corey Feldman.
Corey Feldman.
Yeah, he played Donatello.
Oh, right, that's right.
Yeah, just give me some Corey Feldman.
Corey Feldman. I don't know if you want to say that, because Corey Feldman's been... Have you seen his, like, music stuff?
I have seen his music
stuff. Yeah, that's... He's singing for America. I mean, come on. I don't understand.
He's rocking the Michael Jackson glove.
Yeah, I don't like that at all, because I don't like when celebrities just are able to just do that. Like, old celebrities are able to say, like, I'm doing this now, and then they get all the publicity. That's a whole nother can of worms. That's another episode. But yeah, Michael Bay, I mean, I don't put him in the same category as these other ones, because I think Michael Bay will continue to be Michael Bay. And he's probably at home right now just being like, I'm Michael Bay and I'm amazing, because I just keep because I just
Wait,
keep
doing
well.
Does that imply that the other guys could possibly do better? Because I don't know how the epic movie guys are going to do any better.
It's true. Yeah, I mean, those guys... Well, no, but see, I don't know where they can go from here. I mean, maybe for a little while.
I'd say they just stop making movies.
Yeah.
And instantly they would become more popular and better liked.
Michael Bay has done more than just those types of movies. Yeah. So he has a little more range, actually.
And I actually do like The Rock.
Yeah, no, that
was a great movie.
No, that actually, that's his best.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a great movie.
And then he also did a
movie. Sean Connery, man.
He also did a movie with The Rock called Pain and Gain with Rock and,
I didn't see that one.
I never saw that, but it was about, like, weightlifting. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Fascinating.
Well, Dwayne The Rock Johnson was in it, so.
Yeah. He's the biggest star on the planet right now.
Yeah, man.
And I see you have Tyler Perry.
Yeah.
And specifically Madea.
Yeah, because he's coming out with a new one.
Yeah,
Madea's
Halloween.
I don't get it.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never seen any of... I haven't seen a Tyler Perry movie, and I haven't seen a Tyler Perry show. Maybe I saw one episode of House of Pain, like, once.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever happened to those shows? Like, Tyler Perry's House of Pain, then he had spinoffs like Meet the Browns, and... Yeah.
Oh, wow, I forgot about that.
Yeah,
wow.
But those shows kind of came and went. But for some reason, he's another one where they just give him all this money and they're like, we love your stuff.
He's got a 46 Metacritic score. Like, his critics just don't like his stuff. I've never seen a trailer for anything of his that actually made me go, ooh, I want to watch that. But,
yeah.
I don't know. I just, stop giving people money.
Come on,
Hollywood.
Yeah, that's another one, though, I never seek out.
Yeah.
So, I don't really know. But he keeps doing them.
Yeah.
And doing the same character over and over again, that's got to get somewhat tiresome.
Yeah, it's like, I can't even think of like another, like what other actor does like has a character like that that they keep just chucking at?
Nobody does. I can't think of, or at least like in the movie realm where someone just keeps coming out with the same character over and over again. No, even Eddie Murphy changed it up.
Right.
You know?
I mean, I guess there's like the Austin Powers kind
of
stuff.
Yeah, there's three of them though.
Yeah.
There's three of them. There's been, how many Madea movies have there been? There's been a lot. Yeah. Or at least where Madea shows up. It's not like Jay and Silent Bob.
Right.
It's like, it's the whole movie's focused around.
Yeah, could you imagine they made like 5 Jay and Silent Bob movies?
Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back 6 or... yeah. I don't know.
Jay and Silent Bob 7, Tokyo Drift.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's one I really don't know much about. I think I would like to see one Madea movie, or at least just one thing, just to kind of gauge it. I know Tyler Perry does... As like an actor, he's actually pretty... As like a more serious actor, yeah, he's fine. He's good.
Yeah, I think he was in that movie, Alex Cross.
I didn't see that.
Yeah, I didn't see it either, but that was a more serious movie. He was actually in the Star Trek movie.
Was he?
Yeah. It was a very small role that you saw him and you're like, is that Tyler Perry?
I want to say he was in The Big Short and he was a lawyer.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I'm thinking of that. I might have mixed it up with a different movie. I apologize if I did. But yeah, he's actually a decent actor, so why he does that stuff, I don't know.
Right.
But he makes enough money. I know he does a lot of stuff with Oprah, like producing. I think they produced like Lee Daniels, the butler or something.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I think he does stuff like that. So.
And that was, I haven't seen that one yet, but I hear that was like incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was, I think that was on like the list of, what is it, Oscar movies that I haven't watched yet.
I haven't seen it. Yeah, so that'll be something that I'll have to check out. But I feel like he's kind of similar to Adam Sandler in that way, where they have talents outside of what they showcase for themselves.
Absolutely.
Whereas these guys who do the epic movie stuff, they probably just aren't that good.
Yeah.
Because why? They haven't tried anything else.
Right.
That's all they've done is write shitty spoofs.
Mm-hmm.
They should go away, but they won't, and I just won't see their movies, so whatever.
Essentially, we're...
Play to the lowest common denominator.
Yeah, essentially, we're saying Adam Sandler and Tyler Perry, you guys should make a drama movie together.
Yeah. Yeah, there we go. I think we could pitch something.
Yeah.
We'll write a screenplay.
Excellent.
And we'll get back to you guys.
Perfect.
All right, cool. Do we want to cover anything else, or...?
That's all off the top of my head, that's all I can really think of with those type of, directors or movie makers that you're just like, why do they keep getting money to do these
things? Why bother? Definitely check out, if you're into this sort of thing, definitely check out the podcast, How Did This Get Made? Because that covers a lot of individual movies, but they do it in a really fun way, and it's a lot of really crappy movies that they like to analyze and shit on.
Awesome.
But those are more campy fun.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they do some like straight up bad ones, but most of them are kind of like campy. Like you would have fun watching them, whereas those movies wouldn't be that way.
Well, funny enough, you and I have been receiving a lot of Facebook posts from between our friend group about Tommy Wiseau.
Oh yeah,
coming out with a new movie.
Yeah, but see that's in a whole category by itself.
Yeah, that can... Oh, we should dedicate an entire podcast to that.
Maybe next time.
Next time.
All right.
Next time. There will be no next time.
All right, guys. Well, thank you very much for listening, and we'll see you next time.
Yeah, peace.